Hey guys, in this new video, we're going to take a look at the concept of alkyl groups. So, we're going to say the removal of a hydrogen from an alkane compound creates what we call an alkyl group. Now, remember these alkyl groups are the first step in learning how to name organic compounds. Now, if we take a look at this first compound, CH4. CH4 is an alkane. Remember, alkanes have the formula of CnH2n plus 2. Where n is the number of carbons. It has one carbon, so n is one. Okay, then that'll be H 2 times 1 plus 2. So that's how we got the formula CH4. So this is our saturated hydrocarbon. Saturated meaning the carbon has the maximum amount of hydrogens possible. Now, what do I decide to do? I decide to remove a hydrogen from the methane. Now here, I've removed it, so now it's just a CH3. What does this line here mean? This line here means that this CH3 is connected to some other structure I don't know. Maybe it could be an OH, maybe it could be a larger carbon chain. I have no idea, and it doesn't matter. What we need to realize here is I'm connecting this carbon to something different. Carbon can't make five bonds. I couldn't have the carbon connect to that thing beforehand because carbon can only go up to four bonds. That's why I needed to remove the H from it so that it could connect to some new thing. Now, notice the difference between the two structures. Obviously, we go from CH4, which is methane, to CH3, which is methyl. But what other thing you should notice here is that the end of the name changes when we become an alkyl group. If you take a hydrogen from an N carbon, the ending changes to YL. So here you're going from ane to ill. Okay, so when we make an alkyl group, the ending changes from ane to YL. Now, here methane is CH4, methyl is CH3. Here, we can say that CH2 just means we have a carbon connected to two hydrogens. And then it's connected to two other things. I don't know what they are. I don't really care. Here I'm showing you these guys now because when you get to organic, professors tend to gloss over them and never talk about what their names are. So here they always focus on what a methane is and what a methyl is, but they never explain what a CH2 is called or what a CH is called. Yes, CH, it's connected to three things. We don't know what they are because remember, carbon must make four bonds. We're going to say that a CH2 is called a methylene group. So that's methylene. And a CH is called methine. Here, it's not too important in terms of Gen Chem, but just realize later on when you get to Organic 1, you will have to know what the names of all four of these are. Professors tend to gloss over methylene and methine a lot, and you basically have to figure out on your own that's what they're called. But I'm telling you that now. So make a mental note, write a little note somewhere so that you can remember when you get to Organic 1 that, hey, Jules told me that CH2 is methylene and CH is methine. So if I'm reading and I see those names, I know what the heck I'm looking at. All right, so if we take an H off of methane, it gives us methyl. Then what else could we take an H off of and name as an alkyl group? So we're going to say when you have a two-carbon chain, then the alkane name will be, so let's see, two carbons, saturated, the prefix is F, and it is an alkane, so the ending is ane. Remember, we're taking off an H from one of the N carbons. When we do that, we create an alkyl group, and the ending changes from ane to ill. So it changes from ane to YL. So the prefix name stays the same, so it's F, and the ending changes to ill. So it becomes ethyl. So this is ethyl. And again, we don't know what it's connected to. It can be connected to something. I don't know what it is, but it's connected to it somehow. So that's what an ethyl would look like. Later on, you'll take a look at it in terms of skeletal formulas. For right now, we won't worry too much about that. You'll tackle that more so when you get to Organic 1. Now, if we could take it off of a two-carbon chain, what could we do when we're taking off a three-carbon chain? So here, three carbons is prop. It's an alkane, so it's propane. Here, this is an N carbon, this is an N carbon. I could take an H from either end, And remember, when you're taking off an H from either end, it just changes the ending from ane to YL. So this becomes propyl. But now we finally have a new situation where we don't only have N carbons, we also have a middle carbon here, which means I can remove the H from the middle as well. Now the ending still is ill, but now it's not going to be propyl. Because we're taking it from the middle, this structure is called isopropyl. Iso just means same, and the carbon that is having its H removed so it can be connected to something else is connected to two of the same groups, which basically means these two CH3s. So iso means same. So we'll be making propyl or isopropyl. Now, if let's say you have a four-carbon chain. So, we're going to say here that this four-carbon chain here is called butane. Okay, so that's butane. You could take it from either one of the N-carbons. Again, when you take it from the N-carbon, it just changes the ending to YL. So this becomes butyl. But we also have a new situation where we can take it off from one of the middle guys, which are the same. We're going to say here when you take it off of one of the middle guys, it becomes sec butyl. What the heck does sec mean here? So think of sec meaning secondary. But what does that mean? What is a secondary carbon? A secondary carbon is a carbon connected to two other carbons. Okay, so the carbon that has the bond, this carbon, it is connected to two other carbons. Namely, it's connected to this CH3 and this CH2. So it's a secondary carbon or sec carbon. And because it's a secondary carbon, that's why we call it sec butyl. So it's important that you know what a butyl looks like and what a sec butyl group looks like. So we've figured out half of the name. But where do the other two come from? Well, the other two come from the constitutional isomer of butane. What the heck does constitutional isomer mean? Or structural isomer? So we're going to say constitutional or structural isomer. So constitutional isomer or structural isomer means you have the same exact molecular formula, but different connections. And because you have different connections, you have different names. So on the previous page, we saw that butane was this right here. So this was butane. And if you count the number of carbons and hydrogens, it was C4H10. This one here is called isobutane. It is a structural or constitutional isomer of butane. Because if you look at it, how many carbons does it have? It has 4 as well. And how many hydrogens does it have? It has 10 as well. So isobutane is a constitutional isomer of butane. Same formula, different connections. Now here, this is an N carbon, this is an N carbon, and technically up here is an N carbon. So if we remove from any one of those, it changes the ending to just YL. So the beginning stays iso, but, and then the ending changes to YL. So this would be called isobutyl. Now here, we don't only have those options, but we can remove it here from this middle carbon. It's not one of the N carbons, so we can't just simply say isobutyl anymore. Here we're going to say that it's called tert butyl or T butyl. Okay, so what does tert mean? Tert equals tertiary. What does tertiary mean? Tertiary means that you are a carbon connected to three other carbons. So tertiary means you are a carbon connected to three other carbons. So if we look at this carbon here, it is connected to 1, 2, 3 other carbons. So it is a tertiary carbon. So the name is tertiary butyl, or tert butyl for short, or T-butyl, even shorter. So a carbon connected to two carbons is secondary. A carbon connected to three carbons is tertiary. A carbon connected to one carbon is called a primary carbon. And primary is usually denoted by a one with a degree sign. Tertiary is usually three with a degree sign. Secondary is a two with a degree sign. So carbon connected to one carbon is primary. A carbon connected to two carbons is secondary. A carbon connected to three carbons is tertiary. What do you think a carbon connected to four carbons is called? Well, a carbon connected to four carbons would be called quaternary. And we tend not to talk too much about quaternary carbons. There are a few places here and there in organic that they ever talk about them. But just realize that a quaternary carbon is a carbon connected to four other carbons. And the whole sec, butyl, and terbutyl kind of go off of this idea of that carbon that's making a bond, how many carbons are connected to it. So that's where their names come from. Now, knowing this is important because knowing this will help us answer this following question. We're being asked to draw the three isomers of pentane. So basically, I'm asking us to draw the constitutional isomers of pentane. What are three different ways I can draw this formula and it be correct? So we're going to take a look at this question in the following video. So make sure you come back and attempt to do it alongside me and see what strategy I use in order to draw this correctly. And here's a huge hint. What we just went over in terms of alkyl groups will help us tremendously when it comes to naming this compound or actually drawing these compounds. They provide shortcuts to get to the answer very quickly. Shortcuts that are going to help you a lot in the beginning of Organic 1. Because a typical question is, draw the constitutional isomers from the given formula. So look at the strategies that I use to help guide you to the answer. So come back and look at the next video.